I think we're going to talk now a little bit about the cooperation and the interdisciplinary work, how to get things done, how to implement projects, how to work together. This ski jump we just have seen is one of the examples, recent examples here from Slovenia, where architects and landscape architects work together for the benefit of a good project. Maybe something special, because not everyone is able to design ski jumps or even to use it. But there may be in Slovenia, you have quite some talented ones we know from TV, Prius and company. And so the question is, when is the best time? I ask you first as the architect on site, when is the best time to take landscape architects into the project? Tricky question, I don't know.
It's a tricky question. Fortunately enough, we share office spaces with Anna. So we can take them basically the first second, or we can leave them in vacant space for a month or two. But the bottom line, it depends a lot on the project. I mean, if we get to design office spaces or the interior design, there would be a landscape architect maybe concerning some additional green elements. But in case of urban projects or projects such as Planica, which is placed actually at the edge of the Slovenia largest national park, which is strongly protected with all these natura and ecological considerations, I think that the landscape architect should be there from the first second.
That's very good. I hope it was not only politically meant. Maybe Anna, you say it's the same question, other different answer.
Not much different. I showed already, but with these educational projects, that I think that it's a necessity when we're dealing on a large scale planning that we have to combine the knowledge. And then the tasks could be distributed by, you know, the preferences or the skills that each of us possesses. I think there when we are, for example, collaborating, or you said a better, use a better word, cooperation. I think that's much, much better word. One family, a house and a garden, it's a fact that the house would define the garden. So it's also good to start cooperating at the beginning. Or we could also come and do as much as we could in an existing condition, which we have seen today already by the presentation of Felix, yes. You try to do best within the limitations. But I think that it depends on a project, but it also depends on the level. And the sooner the collaboration starts, the better for the environment.
So maybe we go around and ask everyone for this simple question.
Of course, it's always better the sooner the collaboration starts, but how does this process happen? I mean, often it's the case that basically an architecture or infrastructure project is already quite far developed, and then somebody calls and says, okay, we have these kind of leftover spaces, we don't know what to do with them, we've already taken major decisions, and now we are facing this problem, and this is then really far too late to have a substantial say and a substantial influence in a project. But I think this is still what happens a lot to landscape offices, that they are called into a project far too late. And so for me, always the question is how to become into the process much earlier. I mean, it's a nice coincidence that you are sharing an office, and therefore there is already like a sense of even collaborating if it's not yet an official one, just by talking to each other. So I think, yeah, of course, that's a major precondition to be connected, to know each other, also to value each other in the sense of discussing on a conceptual level different approaches, and then to tackle maybe also a project completely different on the conceptual level than you would do if it was only from a single profession
perspective, and to see also really the benefit in that. And I know from many architects who say, yeah, we really are looking for landscape architects right on the very beginning, on the basic of a very creative conceptual discussion, to get involved, which also means that you need to know them. And I know many landscape architects who don't have such a kind of relationship with architects to be able to do that, and vice versa. And so the question is how to bring both professions into the possibility. And the same with your office. I mean, you are an interdisciplinary office, and that's of course a perfect precondition for that. And maybe you can talk about your experience, how it really works in such a collaborative way, if you're already connected as you are.
I agree.
Yes, I've been for the last 22 years working in Snøhetta, so it's a long condition. And it all started actually with landscape architect and architects from day one in the middle of late 80s. And it was actually more landscape architects than architects, but they're all agreed about, they thought that the built structure meeting the landscape, the site, the context is the most interesting problem with that you work with. That's what, how they want to make design. So I would say that any project in the startup we do in Snøhetta is really always interdisciplinary, or we also call it transdisciplinary, because it's not so much about that you need to take care of your profession. I think it's much more important what you actually adds onto the table to the project. So I think if you have all the disciplines as part of a design team, then maybe people are more free, and instead of maybe too many landscape architects says that, no, we have to do the green structure, we have to do the water. And I don't think necessarily that is the best solution. If there could be a much better idea on the table, and then it's all about sharing. So I think it's partially what you are used to, and we do a lot of competitions. That's also why you can start from day one with all the disciplines in a competition phase, and then you maybe win the design, and then you can keep on working. And a lot of our project, and the client says, no, we just want architects. And we said, no, okay, whatever. We put in interior architects and landscape architects on the team, even if they just pay for architects. So I think that's also up to us. And we also have artists in the office. And that's another challenge to actually get that into, because where does the disciplines actually cross from art to architecture, which is, of course, a totally new discussion. But I think also it's partially what we have been used to do. And I think also what actually the regulations and the politics says. So in Norway for very many years, they say that if you're going to hand in a plan, it needs an outdoor landscape plan, or you will not get through with the plan. So a lot of the architects then take the landscape architects a little bit late into the process, because they need this outdoor landscape plan as well. So I think that is also part of how are the client used to work with landscape architects. Like the Norwegian road authority in the 1990s, they decided that all the authorities needed a landscape architect, at least one. And I think that's the biggest employer of landscape architects in Norway. So there are like 100 landscape architects just working in the road authority, which then means that it's not part of the leftover spaces, it's actually the slopes that make the road. So it's also a way of rethink where is it good to have these different kinds of profession into a project. And you can always say this, yeah, maybe that's an ideal situation, but in the end, it really comes on the person that works in the project. So if you have something you want to share, I think also the project can be pushed much further. Over to Spain.
Just
Catalonia.
No, just
No, I love this question. I think that we definitely have to be the landscape architects who start, and sometimes we should call an architect. That's how I would think about it. Most of the time, if this would happen, there would be a lot of money saving. I wish we were all a bit more Dutch, and it's a pity you are not sitting with. I started my professional career in the Netherlands in a practice called BMB that it's now small, but used to be a very pioneering practice, where architects and landscape architects, and a bit like Snoeta, and what was an absolutely creative situation where the disciplinary debate was not important. The problem is that in undeveloped countries such as Catalonia, the disciplinary boundaries are giving you access or not giving you access to work and are establishing hierarchies. So if we have to establish hierarchies, then I think a landscape architect should be really the beginning. And I really think so, and I'm not joking. I'm thinking because one of the attributes of a good landscape architect would be to be capable to read the context and to read in a geographical, infrastructural scale and to read into a city scale. And it probably need to be as well the quality of a good architect or city planner. But the reality is that there's so many engineering and architectural projects that they are object-like things, and they are completely neglecting the place where they sit in. So I think it's Michel Devigne has a very nice sentence in French, which is very hard to translate into English, which is le paysage en préalable, which means like the landscape before anything. And when I really believe in that, the landscape before doesn't mean the landscape architect before. It means the landscape before. Anyone who cares about such a geographical scale or because then this amazing project you did together, the ski resort. This is an amazing example that when things are at the same time, it just gets the best. And I want to say, like, my practice, we are five people plus stagiaires, people in internship. And we are seven professions. No, I'm joking. But because there's no landscape, you cannot study landscape in Spain as a bachelor. You can only do it like a master. When you are a landscape architect, you already are something before. So in my case, I'm an horticulturalist, but then I have two architects working with me and a biologist. And it's as you say, it's four of us, but there's already five professions, and it just comes naturally that there's the on table discussions, and the problem about that, and I think it's a bit what you are facing as well here in Slovenia, is that such a reality doesn't arrive to the administration, because it's the administration who set the rules and says for this square we need an architect or we need a landscape architect. And if they say we need an architect and a landscape architect, as you just said in Norway, they only pay one, then it comes a second problem.
So we need a solution of the problem. And I liked what you mentioned in your lecture, that there were 50 experts and you had to deal with it and come to an own project at the end. So I think it's really important that the one who has taking the lead is has an understanding of space. And this is quite a lack. But we had this issue now, that translation, that some landscape architects, like Antje said, are not aware where architects are or how to talk to them. It's a language and communication problem, like with the fish and a flamingo. And the other one is to the administration. How to teach the administration what they really have to put in the brief, and who is in charge for what, and who is taking the lead for a good project. Anyone?
I think it's really a challenge that we have to take as architects or landscape architects, that we have to go in that sort of positions, that we are also having people that are clients that has the same background, because then you start to ask for what you need instead of saying it's an economist or somebody that's working in law. They're totally not really interested in architecture. So if we actually are more integrated, both people are politicians and also sit on the client side, I think that's the way to go, because it's not so easy to convince totally different professions that we had to be done in a different way. So we need to be more proactive and be part of the decision making and part of how to make a brief.
Yeah, where to start, at university or the individual, that they just go to the administration instead of trying to be freelance and not earning any money for 10 years. Where to start? Who knows any answer?
I don't really know where to start. I think there are more channels to do it. I think definitely through the education of ourselves, but then also there are other means of educating, let's say, the public to make people more sensitive to the issues of a quality space, of, you know, how this development, urban development, which are the ways to go, like I don't know, being culturally active, being active in writing. Although I'm quite sure that it at the end all reduces down to the political will.
Well, I could say that maybe they have more problems than we have, because nobody discusses if he needs a building or not, but there is a lot of discussion if there should be a tree beside the building or not. But anyhow, I think that actually the process of integrating those two disciplines has already started with or without our true will to encourage it or to stop it, because the every intervention into space has become more and more complex. The influences are now measured much more vigorously as they were, for example, decades ago, and there are knowledges which need to be combined to manage all those influences. And I think basically what architects and landscape architects are doing, they are actually working with the largest scope of influences. And to manage and to calibrate the influences, I think that the collaboration is essential, and I think the administration is also aware of this. Maybe they're not showing, but from the case of experience with Planica, I'm quite sure that all the authorities concerning the preservation of nature would not let the project go on without landscape architects. No go.
I don't know how many buildings in Slovenia are built by architects. In Germany, it's less than 10%. So I think this is another problem that both professions, landscape architects and architects, are going to get obsolete, to quote some famous person. And I think there we have to find a solution, to act politically and, well, not to see the enemies in the wrong place, but to join forces and to be flexible. May I ask, Angie, I know that you are quite good in convincing people they never thought about landscape that they still need a landscape approach. Like anybody knows about harbor authorities? They are like military places you cannot touch, and they have their own laws and everything. But Antje has some experience. Maybe you can talk a little bit about this or some other, where you could convince even the problem was so tricky and confused.
Yeah, I mean, what I also liked really about the both presentations we had by you two this morning is that I think for some actual challenges in terms of spatial development, we need to sometimes go ahead and produce visions and strategic projects without waiting to be asked for it, which is, of course, always an initial investment, but it shows that some spatial decisions need to be taken for projects which are usually not produced by doing competitions and asking for spatial design solutions, which just appear by a logic of building bridges, building roads, building dikes, only based on a call for the best offer, only purely engineering logic. Also with the different administration, parts of the administration not collaborating at all, even fighting against each other. And I think what the two offices also showed this morning, that our great skill is really to synthesize and to really bring together these many aspects and connecting also and linking the different scales. And this is usually something that is not in administration really seen as something that just one part of the administration is commissioning. And so it's by producing these kind of visions and strategic projects, proposals, then to find a way of bringing that into the debate to show that something like that is needed on a strategic level, and try to get an opportunity to be commissioned working in an interdisciplinary team then to do that. If you're not commissioned, you need to do it anyways, I think. And that's the great thing of what you are also doing. And then we always tried, because you were talking about the architecture and the connection, that even there, it's not always that there is a connection with the design of the outdoor spaces. But I think on an engineering level, it's even worse. If we talk about large, I mean, you talk about the administration of roads being the largest body for employing in Germany, it's not like that. And the same about dikes and all kinds of other great, great infrastructure projects where there's so much investment behind, where the sum of having a good design, even the money, would be so little compared to what is spent for these projects. So also, as you asked how we did it, I think we did it this, a bit like you also showed this morning, to produce these kind of visions and try to promote it by public presentations, by organizing workshops, by showing that there are people having these skills, which could then lead to a better, more integrated projects. And we then try to persuade the administration to, for example, to hold a competition for designing a dike, which otherwise would not have been gone through a competition. And then ask also for, in that ideas competition, for an interdisciplinary approach. So to push it also in that way, that they see, okay, we spent a little money for a competition compared to a big investment we will have in the next years to come, which will give us much more spatially better solutions. And then through that competition, we have already like an integrated proposal, which then will link the different professions also together. But yeah, of course, it's sometimes really hard. I mean, even if you promote it through not being commissioned, but just how do you place it? How do you reach the people who are in charge then to be able to spend also money on that?
Yeah, there was one key word I've heard quite often today. This is money, small budget and money, which is the driving force maybe for new solutions. And as I understand landscape architecture, and for example, with water management and these things, it's easy, if we understand natural processes, to present solutions which are much cheaper than any engineering or technical based or strong structure. But sorry, if yours went in another direction.
I think that there's in this construction of new missions, new visions, I think it was very interesting the presentation of Felix, because there's as well, there's narrative about how to make more multifunctional landscapes, which integrate ecology, social things, and this narrative, I think, in a way, are a bit tricky, because if you know them, you can repeat them, and it sounds so good. You get points in a way, but at the same time, if you believe in them and you know how to turn a narrative into a drawing, into a message that has that talks the language that the politics may understand. And I think that the whole presentation of Felix is an example about how things that initially would have not been that easy by a powerful narrative got through. No, the Russian development or this was not what they were expecting, but by being very strong in the narrative and by narrative, I'm not talking about the talking, I'm also talking about the all representational thing that goes, then something that is initially impossible becomes possible. And with money happens, it's a bit the same. It's like if you sort of kind of demonstrate that with little money you can do it, then somebody that initially would not give a shit then eventually would open the eyes. And I think that's one of the challenges of the practice. And I love you ask me that. What are the challenges of the practice, of the discipline? And I think there's two very important things. One is this idea of multifunctionality, which is not my thing. It's everywhere. Right? So, and that's very much about what you were mentioning before about design. It's about not considering like fluxes of cars. It's about considering a lot of things at the same time. Like, so in order to spatially interpret multifunctionality, you already need professions, number of them. And the other one to me is this idea, maybe you use a word performability or whatever. It's this idea of infrastructure. The landscapes are infrastructures providing goods for the and for quality of life for the citizens. So the idea of infrastructure to me, it's not a tree next to a house. It's a substantial things for the society, and it also refers to a larger scale or true scales. So to me, the society needs multifunctional spaces that they can perform in a number of ways, but also in a number of ways through the day and through the seasons. And also it needs an infrastructural thought, different scales. And that needs different professions. And one of the first professions that should arrive for me is landscape. And I do believe that, because when I see project, when this happens, they normally are good in the result, but also they are money saving. Which is your last question.
Yeah, we already spoke about the communication problem and that the administration and the politicians must understand what we think if we promise better environments. But we should talk about the society, about the user, about the people, about us, what is necessary to take them into the boat and forcing or forming a force, being loud and with the participation process, come to a better support for a livable environment. I think this is just in the last years when we had the populist political movements. It's very important not to do anything which comes from top down, but from bottom up, to support a little bit without all these creating these rubbish places, but something with quality which is working. Who has something to say or experience in this field, how participation could help you with your project to bring good quality? Maybe architects?
Well, it's hard to talk about the large-scale experiences, but actually having many voices can have many results. And in most cases, I think that there would be a mess at the end. So the architect or the manager of the process basically is the one who needs to take an extra work. So he should foresee all or almost all of the possibilities, and then to set the set of choices which would then lead the whole project into the like I said, the coherent goal. And in fact, that is basically the general principle of participation, that you should see far further ahead than if you would be the only one to decide what to do with the project. And that's a really hard thing, and would go same as you said before, that there would be only 10% of the buildings which are actually designed and then constructed according to the architect or landscape architect's plans. So this administrative role of guiding people how to build their houses by themselves is in fact basically a participatory project, because they participate with their ideas, with their money, and with their workload. So how to steer the urban development in such a way that there's basically a set of choices is something which I think that the urban planning has not yet tackled on very administrative level. So these master plans would never set choices. They would just set this is that, and this is allowed, and this is not allowed. So I think that is a level of our profession which is still needed to be attacked on a very systematic level.
Maybe Anna can tell us how to attack this problem, for example, in Ljubljana.
Well, there in Ljubljana, there has been a good master plan actually put up in the last decade, also including a form of participation, because there are many forms of participation. There is a question which has been addressed, I'm sure, at least in, but not only in the academic world, is how to produce a master plan for an urban development, but which is obligatory, but not tying you up. So it's flexible enough to adjust possible transformation, because it is. The plan is talking about the future, and the future is uncertain, and futures are more and more uncertain, as we can see. There was just up now, there is a discussion in Slovenia about actually the need for some planning that would precede individual actions, because individual actions can be so fragmented that everything falls apart. If you're focused on only one part, you cannot see other possibilities, which may be not only cheaper but also much better. And I agree very much with Marty in the way that how and when landscape architects should approach the cooperation, because sometimes they not only are more systemic and they have a specific knowledge to understand and read the space, which architects also have, but different ones. I think a landscape architect can recognize the potential of a landscape change. So that's why it can be helpful. But for really how to produce a master plan that would be flexible enough, I don't have an answer yet.
Well, it's a part of our professions in the planning field is to be dynamic and to react on things are changing and it's nothing is fixed. And so there are different corporations and different also different jobs to do, to be done. And now with the climate change and all these things, it's getting more and more complicated. But we have to be trained and skilled. And Marty wanted to add.
Very shortly. One of the landscape architects I admire the most is Michel Devigne and Dal Noki. It's a French couple, used to be a French couple. And in one lecture, Dal Noki, the female partner in the business, she said that, as you said, only we are the landscape architects, we are so marginal that we should enjoy, just have fun, you know? Because anyway, we are not the ones building the landscape is done by the engineers and the urban planners, and then for the builders and the people who. So our responsibility is to make amazing pieces of work, because we are the experimental. Anyway, we are just an anecdote. So we should take our profession seriously and have fun, and then show models. If what you do is relevant, then that's what you do about traveling. When you travel and you go to, for us in the south, we go to the north normally, we get inspired. Say, well, you know, I was in a lecture the other day in Denmark. They are doing a school where the patio for the kids has no fences. It's in the middle of the street. It's possible. So, I mean, that there's something very powerful about the things that have been done. So I think one of the nice challenges for anyone, not architects and landscape architects, all these small professions that we are, is to build things that they are inspiring. And this has a power by itself. And I think that's very inspiring, the skiing. It's like now everyone that will make this will come to see it, because it has a power in itself. And it's a power about the alliance of professions and so on. That's one thing. And then it's one thing that Martin Reincano from Topotec says all the time, is that the profession of landscape architect has been always a bit like the lady in the 50s and 60s that was sitting in the dancing ground, sitting a bit like this, waiting for the men to go to dance. Yeah? Well, yeah, but waiting for the men to go to take her to dance. And he said, well, I think we should emancipate. He always used this word, emancipate. And as a profession, we should start dancing without men inviting us. Well, obviously, you got the point. Huh?
I just had to add, because I don't think it's marginalized. We have to use the power we have. Instead of saying, no, it's that boring old lady sitting and never was asked to dance. I mean, we have to go in lead. And I think also that's, yeah. But I think also that's part of to be a decision maker or to be a team leader. To be a team leader of a large project that has engineers and architects and any kind of discipline. So I think it's both ways. We should always have fun. I totally agree about that. I think that's really important. But to always say that, no, we're the little sister, you know, we can't really do it. No, because I think it's really important. Because it's so powerful what we're doing. So I think that's a really, really important message. And just one little thing adding for the participation, because I think that's very hard. It's really tricky. But it's really important. And I feel now it's like it's coming back from the 70s, that everything was participation, and it was overdoing it. And it was also everybody was the same and everybody's equal, which is to a certain point is absolutely excellent and good, and then it tips over. So how now to plan for a space, if it's architecture, it's the building, or it's the public realm, how to actually look into the future? I mean, that's how can we ask somebody that maybe will be a user in some years? I mean, how could they know? We should be there to lead them. We should listen. I think it's really important that we listen. But then we also have to make professional choices based on design, based on what we believe in will be good. Because if you always say that, no, the people should decide, yes, I really believe in participation, but in the end, we have to make the choices to show that this is important. And I think also it's really important to start teaching it at university. I teach a couple of design courses, and participation is part of that, to actually understand there is a user out there. Because students, first year, second year, there's so many things to learn that you forget that's actually, it's all about people. 98.7% of what we are actually designing is just for people. And then we should maybe work even broader. I work together with a social anthropologist, which of course has a totally different view of what participation is. And I think that also with everybody moving more to the city, we get more urban, we have less space, we need more green spaces, and how to actually get that on the table and look into the future. And we're much more globalized, so everybody is moving around, and we really have to think, how can we integrate people better? It's a very large theme, but I think it's extremely important that we are in front and try to actually include people in our processes.
I also think that one of the main misconceptions about participation is you go out and you ask the people, what do you want? You get the answers and then you take it up directly. Because, I mean, I really like your notion of the quote you took by Richard Sennett about the disruptive experiences. Because if the ordinary experience, it doesn't lead then to much that you can notice outside of that. And a part of a participatory process is our role of also causing that kind of disruptive experience through also actions and small scale changes, which might then enable a completely new perception, a new use of space that was never foreseen and that people would have never also told you if you would have asked them. But that still is, in a way, experimental and also reversible, to see it as more as a process than having the large master planner who is the person who knows everything and can look into the future, but really make it a journey through incremental steps of different actions that are taken to learn from, which then might also change the path that we go together with the people. And I think we need to cause these disruptive actions. We need to, and the designs need to also be provocative, and through that enable also a change towards a certain
spatial layout, which would not have come from just asking the people and collecting their ideas and then trying to incorporate that into a design.
Just very short. Don't give people what they think they want, because they deserve much better.
And because they don't know what they want, you know? They always want what they know and not the unknown, and we should know a little bit more, be further ahead, and we have to interpret what they really mean, and then we need a standing. I'd say we, I'm a journalist, not a planner, but we have to have a standing if it is a creative process and we are convinced. For example, the Oslo Opera, Ballet and Opera House, I think there was no participation process about this and that and the material and blah. It was a coordination process in the government and in politics and the administration, everything, and finally the architects needed a standing to have the white marble and to have it like it is, and blah, and with no tree around, so there was no landscape architect involved because there's no tree. True? No.
The brief for the competition didn't have any single word about public plaza, because it should just be a building, and it has this stamp regulation. So, I mean, there was a lot of participation with the users at the opera and the ballet and the administration working there, but of course not with the public. I mean, they never asked for a plaza. I mean, they didn't ask for that. I mean, we gave them the fifth facade, which is the roof, and turned it into a public plaza. That was not asked, we gave them something extra.
Matej, here in Ljubljana, you architect, you get the job to build an opera house or a museum. Would it be possible to do something extraordinary, just like having a public plaza on the rooftop? Or something else?
Well, I think in case of Oslo, well, there would be a possibility if the site of the new development would allow for uncommon uses. For example, having the construction in the middle of the town, where basically a lot of things are already set, there this alternative way of understanding the common topologies, it's probably much harder to achieve. But for example, if we would go for gray zones or for the edge of town, where, like we heard today, the ecologies mix or they meet, I think there the shift of typology is much easier to achieve. And for another reason also, because people would not be preconceived what to expect there. There any kind of design solution could actually work, because nothing is said in advance. But as I said, in city center, I think that's much, much, much harder to achieve. And just going slightly back to the question of this participation, sorry, just jumping back, but it's actually also a hard moral question. As we heard it before, it's dealing with, you know, something which people need today is not what they will need in 50 years, but whatever we put in space is for 50 or even for 100 years. So whom to believe? Yourself, people, they would be happy for 2 years, but maybe afterwards this would become obsolete. So that's a huge moral question.
What's the risk we have to take? Anna?
Yes, something about the possibility to build Snoheta Opera in Ljubljana. I mean, I must say this in the favor of a municipality that in the case of Sports Park Stoj, this could almost happen. At the beginning, everybody was very ambitious in precisely, it was on the edge, there was enough room, and it was quite experimental. Even the idea of having the roof of stadium being like a little hill on which you could walk and have these kites flying, etc., because it's a wind corridor, so it would be a physical outcome of understanding the position within the landscape and the natural processes. So it is possible, of course, but it's the two factors were stopping it. One was financial, and one was now the political collapse of the project. And adding to the participation, yes, we've heard it is, of course, when an architect or a landscape architect is leading a participation, it does has an ethical responsibility, not only legal and professional, also an ethical responsibility of listening, also showing. I think it's a possibility to show people the problems and how their egos are confronted by other people's egos in the same bowl, and maybe there's a way to resolve the conflicts through the process and then together envision a better future. And I would go back to what the strategy that Matej, you presented for Planica. Maybe the role of architect and the power of design is to pull all these things together and give them a shape, instead of just envisioning a shape or a form in your head and then putting it out.
I think it's really hard. The time is over, so the break is waiting for you, I know. And so it's really hard to sum it up. And thank you very much for the moment. Thanks for your very interesting contributions.